My name is Omayra Ortega. I'm an assistant professor of mathematics and statistics at Sonoma State University in Sonoma County, California. I was always good at math as a child. My mom really loves to play games. I mean, my whole family always played games together. So I think that early start just always made me have an interest in mathematics. And I mean, from preschool on, I was always good at math. I'm not really sure of when I realized that I wanted to be a mathematician. I know that throughout my schooling and even in high school, I had this idea that I would be a math major, but I never thought about being a mathematician or doing research in math necessarily. Definitely throughout my college career, I continued to study math, but I also studied music. I was a double major, and so I really wasn't sure what I was going to do after I graduated. But then I participated in an REU, a research experience for undergraduates, at Cornell University called the Mathematical and Theoretical Biology Institute, MTBI. And that pretty much set my path. I knew I was going to be a college professor. I knew I wanted to do research in math biology, and I was set. So I would say that that summer research experience set me on the path for doing research in mathematics specifically. The type of mathematics that I work on are, it's called mathematical epidemiology. And in this field, I create mathematical equations or create math formulas that will describe what's happening within a group of people, within a population, as a disease is coming through. So I can create a formula that says how many people might get infected on one day, or how many people might get infected in a week, or how many people get infected in a year. So I can make predictions about how an infection grows or dies down, or if we're really interested in how an infection moves throughout a population or geographically through space, then we can also create a spatial model that describes and counts the number of infections in different places. So it's really just taking formulas to try to make predictions about what's going to happen with the disease. And we use math and we use statistics for this. More specifically, I use differential equations based models, for the most part, differential equations based models to describe infection in a population. And so differential equations deal with rates of change. And so you might be interested in how many infections are going to happen per day. So the way that the infections increase over time. Okay, so time is going and infections are going up at the same time. So relating those two rates. And then a system of differential equations is where we take a whole bunch of equations, a whole bunch of these differential equations, so all of these rates of change, and relate them to each other. And so you would have, I gave you the example of just those two, but you could have, you can include a lot of different things. So we might be interested in the rate that the infection goes up, but at the same time as people who were already sick, how quickly they recover. Then also I was talking a little bit about sort of spatial models, so models that incorporate geography in them. So then you also might want to include, well, how fast are people even moving? Are people even moving around and where are they going? Those are things that you could also incorporate into an infectious disease model. So I'm trying to remember back earlier in my career, the challenges that I faced. I think for me, it was very difficult to leave my comfort zone and go to graduate school in Iowa City, Iowa. It's very cold there. And the state itself is not very diverse, but I will say the city where the university is, I think that transition was a little rough for me. I grew up in New York City. I went to college in Los Angeles, and then I went to Iowa City. And truthfully, I chose that place partially because I was thinking, oh, I've never been to the Midwest before. I need to see what's going on in the middle of the country. But the first year of grad school is probably difficult for everyone. I think it was just especially acute for me because of the culture shock that went along with it. And then I think that classes-wise, it took me a little while to realize that I really can't do anything other than mathematics while in grad school. Throughout my high school career and my undergrad career, I was very active in everything. And I remember that first semester at Iowa trying to take a Chinese class at the same time. And I failed miserably. I failed miserably, like all around. It didn't help my grades in my math classes, and I didn't do that great in that Chinese class. So I just had to learn to be more focused in graduate school and then also acclimate to the culture. That was difficult for me. I think after graduate school, although I was trained in research in grad school, once I was on my own and a faculty member, it was very hard for me to establish research groups and research collaborations. I didn't know how to do that. I had a thesis advisor in grad school. I just had this like ready-made human being that was gonna work with me all the time. But I didn't know how to cultivate those relationships. And truthfully, I think I'm only now figuring that out. And I graduated 12 years ago with my PhD. So it took a little while. And I'm not sure that that's something that can be taught, but it definitely can be modeled. And I mean, it's just unfortunate that I didn't get that training beforehand, but knowing that now, I know how to talk to other people about how they should start cultivating these research collaborations and research relationships. So I think those are sort of the two biggest things that I dealt with throughout my career. My proudest accomplishments in my career all come from seeing my students succeed. I have been very honored to mentor some undergraduates in research. I've also directed some summer undergraduate research, but throughout the academic year, I maintain a very small undergraduate research group. There's usually like between 2 and most 5 students in a semester doing research. Sometimes it's all as one group. Sometimes they want to do individual projects. I try to give them some autonomy in choosing the projects so that I keep them engaged. My first group of students, I think that group was in 2008. So one of them finished with her PhD in computer science. She does artificial intelligence work. She's up in Seattle. She's about to start working for Microsoft. So proud. Another student who she always told me she was interested in the actuarial sciences, but she wanted to do research in statistics with me. And she's zooming along. She's an actuary. She's having her own career successes. I have another student who she got her master's in bioinformatics. It was this joint collaboration between the Mayo Clinic and Arizona State University. And she started her own business. She does modeling, but also like sanitation. I mean, like advising on how to keep businesses clean, essentially, but so that you're not spreading infection. And so I'm just talking about, I think I just mentioned 3 out of the like 15 students. I could go on and on and on about my students, but I just love when they write me back, let me know that they've gotten into med school or whatever it is that they're doing. Just, I love to see them thrive. I'm gonna apologize from the beginning because I can't possibly name them all, but Amy Radinskaya was my undergraduate thesis mentor, and she continues to support me and push me to this day. I'd say Carlos Castillo Chavez, he is the director of the MTBI program. When I was a student, continues to this day, he founded it. He's definitely lit a fire under me. And then, like I said, I wouldn't be a mathematical epidemiologist if not for him and his program. Otherwise, there's a lot of people that I just think are just amazing. Marion Edelman Wright started the Children's Defense Fund. I just really admired her tenacity and her spirit. There's so many strong and wonderful people who I think are doing good in the world that inspire me. And so I can't say I have like a role model. I just named sort of my 2 biggest ones in mathematics, but there's so many. Erica Flappin, Edric Goines, Sylvia Bozeman, Mr. Dr. Bozeman, all of these. I mean, so many people, I can't even, but I'm just so thankful that these people came before me to just help me and show me the path. I think for a lot of students and for me, if no one showed me the way, I would just be like wandering in circles in the dark. So I'm so thankful for these people, for these role models, and for these mentors. I have a couple of phrases that I say to myself and I keep in my mind when I need to stay motivated and stay productive. In particular, there's a Japanese proverb that goes, fall down 7 times, stand up 8. And it really is speaking to you know, there's going to be challenges in your life. You're going to make mistakes. You're going to have embarrassing moments. It's just going to happen. That's life. But what's important is what you do after. Okay, you're going to fall down. You need to get back up. I mean, there's that saying, you know, you got to get back on the horse. You got to get back on the horse. So, you know, things are going to happen. Things are going to happen throughout your career, throughout your life. I also just want to say it's important to keep, like, have a good network, have a good support system. You know, keep your friends close. And you can have math friends that you can, you know, complain about math things or, you know, celebrate math things with. And, you know, you have your, like, your family, the people that are your friend family, and you can, you know, complain about personal things or, you know, celebrate personal successes. And those. So it's just important to have people in your life that are going to be your cheerleaders and your confidants. So, you know, don't isolate. So just make sure to, you know, keep your support system, you know, functioning and close. Those are my words of wisdom.